Howdy everyone. In this video, we're going to address using HR data in Gen AI applications. The reason we are talking about this today is we are seeing organizations more and more building Gen AI applications, and they're starting to bring people data into these applications. And so we want to be very careful about how that happens. We're going to have three main scenarios as we go through everything. In today's video, we are going to have a scenario that focuses really on using personally identifiable information and sensitive personal information used to train and tune AI models. And this will be the focus today. And the thing that we're really concerned with around this topic is we want to make sure that we're responsibly and securely handling the sensitive information that we're using to train our models. Now, let's go back and look at actually the Gen AI architecture in the model and start with that as our base. So first, we're trying to build an AI application. We link that to a large language model. Now, these large language models have a lot of information in them, and typically they never use any personally identifiable information within the LLMs. We do have users who are going to interact and do a prompt on the AI application. It's going to prompt to the LLM and bring us back a nice human language response back to the user. Now, because there's no information from the organization, there's no people data within this, if we want to build applications, HR AI applications, we're going to have to bring that information in. So we need to make sure that we start looking then at information that does contain people data, but it also contains policies around HR and how to handle situations for an organization. We're going to embed this information in a vector database so that we can use it as part of our model. And now we have a system where we can actually prompt, go down, get the actual information, the relative information we need, and bring the response back. So this is the starting point that we have. This is also known as a RAG model of a generative AI. So, let's think about our use cases. So when we're going to build the system, it really helps if we look at very specific use cases to help guide us in our discussion of how we're going to handle PI. So let's look at use cases for managing this. The first one we want to look at is an HR support use case. Now, this model is really around case resolution. So an HR support team member that needs to look at a case that's brought forward around an HR or a people question, they need to look and be able to pull back historical information to help and guide them in a system and making the right proper response for that question. So that's our first use case. Second use case that we're going to look at is a policy question and answer chatbot. So this is really allowed. You have general information around policies around travel, around hiring new employees, around whatever things that you need to just have general information around for policies within HR, and you just want to do a Q&A and get a quick response back. The nice thing about having this as part of our Gen AI or our RAG model is that we can have consistency in all responses when people start querying stuff. And this is used by managers, can be used by whoever needs to use this. All right. So this is the system that we're developing. Now, since we're looking at the training part of this, we are going to have a developer in here that's building our application out. And so they're sitting in here in the middle. They're actually looking at the data that are going to be training off of. This contains sensitive information. It's flowing into our vector database. So we really want to look at how are we going to protect this data when we're doing the training and the tuning of these models so that we can then support our use cases. So to address this, we're going to come up with a set of strategies to help us best protect the HR data when we're doing our training. So the first strategy that we're going to really recommend is that you understand the distinction of the data that you're using in your training. And this is really around you have confidential data and you have privacy data. Now, back to our drawing, when we talk about the people data and we're bringing this into our HR Gen AI model, this is really privacy information. This is information about individuals. And this is information we want to make sure that we protect correctly. Then we have confidential information. This is information, these are the policies, these are the HR policies that are part of our corporate HR. And this can actually be visible to, you know, a broad set of individuals that will be using the system or even training the system. And so we'd be less protective about this. But it's very important that we classify this data correctly, so that we don't inadvertently expose data that we don't want to expose. The second strategy that we want to pull in here is that we only want to use data that the users are already have access to. And this is important. If we're going to develop a Gen AI system that uses very sensitive information and we have to go and check all the different controls of who's allowed to see what, it makes this a very difficult problem. It's a known problem, but it's a difficult problem. It'll actually be a topic for a future video. But if we're trying to make a strategy where we can quickly implement stuff and protect that data, then what we want to do is make sure that when we're designing and building it, the end user, and even in this case, the developer, they already have access to the data that's going to be used to build the system. So we don't have to worry about complex controls. The third strategy that we want to make sure and bring into this is that we want to opt for coarse-grained anonymization. And this is really important in the training phase of this because, as mentioned before, we do have a set of sensitive personal information here. And we do, to a large extent, want to protect it from the people who are tuning and training our models. So by using anonymization techniques, we can make sure that that data is not exposed to people who cannot see it, especially when we're doing our training and our tuning and our fine-tuning. Once we move this into production, we can then eliminate the needs, you know, for having the anonymization in place. You may still choose to do that, but at least when we're talking about this first scenario of training and tuning, this is a good strategy to follow. All right, so now that we've looked at this, we're looking at our first scenario, we're looking at how do we build this, how do we train and tune, we've looked at the HR cases we want to address, and we've come up with a set of strategies to how to best be responsible and securely protect the personal information. Thank you for joining me on this video today. I want to do a special shout out to my partner on this topic, Pietro Mazzolini, and I also want to invite you to come back and see part two in this series of this video on HR data in Gen AI applications.